Nintendo's company history is an incredibly interesting story that's been told more times than I can count. This section touches on the important parts needed for me to give context to the rest of this video, but for more thorough analyses, check the description for recommendations. With that out of the way, let's begin. Nintendo was founded in Kyoto in 1889 by Fusajiro Yamauchi as a Hanafuda company. These Japanese playing cards were used for a variety of games, not unlike American cards. However, after Japan banned gambling in 1882, Hanafuda saw a surge of popularity, often used by the Yakuza in under-the-table gambling parlors. Yamauchi took advantage of this rise in demand, and, for the first 80 years of the company's history, this was their main specialty. In 1959, Nintendo contracted with Disney to produce cards with their likeness, which were sold in toy stores, the company's first introduction to the industry. In 1964, shifts in public demand for Hanafuda, due to the influx of popularity in other entertainment sectors, such as bowling and pachinko, led to declining sales for Nintendo, culminating in their lowest stock price ever at just 60 yen. It was clear to Hiroshi Yamauchi, the great-grandson of founder Fusajiro Yamauchi, and then president of the company, that they needed to make some changes. Gunpei Yokoi, an employee and member of Nintendo's research and development department who had a background in electronics manufacturing, was made the head of Nintendo's games department in 1969. While they produced several tabletop games during this period, including chess, go, and shogi, the real breakout was with the release of their first electronic toy, the Nintendo Beam Gun, in 1970. This device was eventually used in shooting range simulations, called the Laser Clay Shooting System, located in repurposed bowling alleys, a trend that had died down in recent years. It was also shrunk down to fit as a peripheral for the Magnavox Odyssey, a new home video game console. Several other electronic toys were made by Nintendo in subsequent years, including the Ultra Hand and Ultra Scope, which performed quite well. There was a high demand for electronics, and Nintendo wasn't going to disappoint. In 1974, Nintendo made their first arcade simulation, Wild Gunman. This was essentially a smaller version of the Laser Clay Shooting System. It was exported to Europe and America, where it enjoyed moderate success, but the slow production time and high cost greatly hindered its longevity. Nintendo dabbled in game console distribution, produced the first microprocessor for video games, and made several other arcade cabinets. But the next notable event occurred in 1977, when Shigeru Miyamoto was hired. 1979 saw the opening of Nintendo's first subsidiary in New York, as well as the company shifting their focus to arcade cabinet production. The Game & Watch, a series of handheld video game and alarm watches developed by Yokoi, came out in 1980 and proved to be widely successful. Releases would continue into 1991 and sold very well both in Japan and overseas, featuring many now iconic high score-based time waster games, including Ball and Fire. In 1981, Nintendo's first major success in the video game industry would be released, Donkey Kong. Designed by Shigeru Miyamoto, the cabinet featured a big ape, Donkey Kong, a character known as Jumpman and would later be known as Mario, and a damsel in distress, Pauline. It was a hit all over the world and would be ported to both Game & Watch systems as well as the Atari in the following years. This financial boon allowed Nintendo to relocate their American offices from a small rented facility on the East Coast to a full-blown building in Seattle, Washington. After the success of Donkey Kong, its sequel, Donkey Kong Jr., and other arcade titles produced by Nintendo, like Mario Bros. And Popeye, they decided to get into the home console market with their own system, called the Family Computer, or Famicom. Released exclusively in Japan in July of 1983, it launched with three home console ports of their most popular arcade games, Donkey Kong, Donkey Kong Jr., and Popeye. That just about catches us up to the present-day Nintendo, at least for this video's purposes. But, of course, this isn't about the Famicom, it's about the NES. While Nintendo was striking it big in Japan, trouble was afoot in the American console market. Let's zoom into the historical significance of this year for the electronics industry in America, otherwise known as the video game market crash of 1983. America, 1976. General Instruments, an established electronics company, produced a series of affordable integrated chips for video game consoles that allowed for cheap and simplified console production. At first glance, this may have seemed promising. There weren't many home video game consoles in the first generation, the Magnavox Odyssey, Coleco, and Home Pong systems among the most popular, but with their lack of games, they left much to be desired. So, more competition could only mean more quality, right? Well, in reality, the affordability of producing these systems flooded the market with tons of poor quality Pong clones and many unlicensed arcade game knockoffs. The second generation of consoles, notably including the Atari 2600, Magnavox Odyssey 2, and the Intellivision, was privy to many issues that severely diminished both consumer and retailer trust. Generally, the market was flooded with a multitude of mediocre at best consoles. The ease of manufacturing led to an astounding 10+ systems being sold, which led to consumer confusion at stores. Many systems didn't offer anything different from their competitors. Lower price points could be synonymous with lower quality, and worst of all, demand for consoles was overprojected and thus overcompensated for, leaving many systems to rot on store shelves. This was the first big factor that led to major issues both with consumers and store owners, who would end up having to deal with expensive electronics that would never sell. Another key issue was the lack of publishing control. In 1979, four employees from Atari who had left the company due to labor disputes decided to form their own company, Activision, and manufacture carts for the Atari on their own. While there were attempts to stop this by Atari themselves, it was ultimately decided by the court that Activision would pay Atari royalties, but that they would still be allowed to produce their own games. This would soon be taken advantage of by several other companies who did not have the same experience as Activision employees when it came to making solid titles. Companies like Imagic, Mattel, Coleco, and so on sought to take advantage of the cheap production costs and put out as many video games as they could, no matter the quality. In 1977, the year of the Atari's release, there were zero third-party companies producing games for the system. In 1982, there were upwards of 17. In 1983, there were more than 100. Most games were clones of other popular titles, few were made with any expertise, and most presented as exactly what they were: cash grabs. In addition to this, competition was increasing with home computer systems. If game consoles cost the same as computers, which play games as well as serve as word processors, why would anyone buy a console? Well, understandably, few did. False advertising also played a major part in the lack of trust in electronic entertainment devices. Many games would have elaborate artworks on the cover or extremely exciting commercials, but would turn out to be far from what was portrayed. Flag Capture is a wonderful example of this. The cover art shows a mystic band of pirates fighting against a British ship in a high-quality sea battle, promising a whopping 10 games in one, while the gameplay looks like this. This really came to a head with E.T. and Pac-Man, two highly anticipated releases that ended up as absolutely abysmal games. Pac-Man was an arcade sensation. It would come as no surprise that a home console port would be created. Unfortunately, the console version on the Atari ended up performing extremely poorly due to the terrible graphics and disgusting adaptation of gameplay. It made 8-year-olds around the world cry, according to this YouTube comment. On the other hand, E.T. was developed in less than 6 weeks by a team of two, rushed to completion to meet the Christmas season of 1982 while still capitalizing on the hype of the Spielberg film. The game's initial sales were successful, but there ended up being over 660,000 returns due to the uninspired gameplay and very poor graphics. While many cite these games as the sole reason for the video game crash, I believe that they may have been the straw that broke the camel's back. As a result of these misguided business decisions and general trend of greed in the industry, the video game market had dropped from $3.2 billion in 1982 to just $100 million in 1985. Atari alone lost around $536 million by the end of 1983 and was shipping massive quantities of unsold product to be disposed of via landfill in New Mexico. Arcades were also hit quite hard. The golden age of the arcade had come to an end, with revenues down by around 40% across the country. Outside of just numbers, the crash had a notable societal impact. People started to view video games as nothing more than a fad. Investors saw the unregulated industry as a dangerous gamble. Stores were unwilling to put any electronics on their shelves for fear of more unsold inventory. However, out of these ashes, a new idea would be born. Nintendo had plans to bring the Famicom over to the States as early as 1984, but knew better than to enter the market at such a dire time. While Nintendo was a name already known in the States, as they had been producing several popular arcade cabinets, the Game & Watch and the Nintendo Versa system, an arcade cabinet featuring interchangeable ROM chips that utilized the same technology as the carts inserted into the Famicom, they had yet to break into the home console market with the same vibrato. They spent the next 2 years identifying all of the factors that led to the collapse of the Western market and attempted to engineer the perfect answer to each of the misgivings of their American counterparts. First up was the physical design of their unit. Rather than making it look like a sleek, futuristic video game system as originally planned and presented at the Consumer Electronics Show in 1984, Nintendo of America's lead designer, Lance Barr, tried to frame the NES as a VCR, something that wouldn't look out of place next to a TV. Instead of slotting games on top of the system like the Famicom, they would be loaded into the center port manually, pressed in and down to latch into place. When closed, this would obfuscate any view of the cartridge, helping to conserve its visual status as an unassuming TV peripheral. Its sleek top and two tones also gave it a very futuristic feel, far from the wood-paneled 60s look of the Atari 2600. There really were negative associations with the simple term video game, so rather than call the device the Nintendo Advanced Video Gaming System, its original name, they changed it to the Nintendo Entertainment System, highlighting the entertainment aspect of the system. The games themselves weren't called video games, but rather game packs. The paperwork packed with the console was noticeably absent of any allusion to video games, and all of the manuals were careful to avoid the V-word as well. They did everything they could to distance themselves from the idea of a video game. The next step was determining what games should be brought to the system. The Famicom started with home console ports of arcade titles, but the NES would have to launch with a lot more than that to keep it exciting. Nintendo was able to gauge interest in their games through several sources. First off, they had a sort of pre-test market through the Versa system arcade cabinet. This was how America got their first glimpse at Nintendo's console games. By measuring which games did the best in the arcade, Nintendo could cater their launch titles to the new market. Minoru Arakawa, the president of Nintendo of America, also consulted with Howard Phillips, a longtime employee at Nintendo, even if he was only a warehouse manager at the time. Their small team wrote down what games they thought would fit best in the American market. The rest of this essay will be surrounding titles that were among the first to be released on the NES, colloquially called the Black Box Games. On the marketing side, Nintendo of America didn't want to release the system nationwide to see what would happen. Instead, they decided to test the market in October of 1985 by launching the NES with select retailers in New York City. It's not like retailers were particularly thrilled to let a video game console into their stores. They were expensive and had a bleak history to them. In order to entice their managers, Nintendo promised to buy back any stock that didn't sell at full price, giving store owners little to no risk. To accompany the retail launch, a small team of employees had been running around, setting up kiosks to get the public interested in the system. These displays featured a giant ROM and a series of video game screenshots, along with the contents of the test market set. A commercial highlighting the futuristic birth of Rob the Robot was aired. All of these designs and setups had been concocted at the last minute. They rushed to get this thing off the ground, and it was obvious in the poor record keeping that can be seen in the company 35 years later. But we'll go into that soon. In terms of the technology, Nintendo had already identified that one of the major issues in 1983 was the lack of third-party regulation. In fact, since 1984, the Famicom had already begun seeing its fair share of low-quality releases from unaffiliated game designers. While many third-party titles were solid, the sheer amount of companies that wanted to get in on the console's success were very quickly muddying up the market for both producers of new, high-quality games and consumers looking to buy solid titles. The Famicom had no device to identify unlicensed games, but this would soon change for their launch of the system in America and Europe. By including a lockout chip in the console, developers would be forced to go through Nintendo before having their games approved, allowing the company to verify each and every title before it made it to market. This also made developers go through Nintendo's production facilities in order to actually produce games, allowing them to control the amount of titles any third party put out while standardizing the designs for the carts. There were some drawbacks to this as well. if the pins that read the NES carts became loose or broke off, a common phenomenon when children begin handling expensive electronic equipment, games would become entirely unplayable, and the console would necessitate complex repairs to resume function. Also, some of the games that used custom software with more complex graphics and sound that came out in Japan would have to be reworked in order to function properly on US and European systems. Overall, though, this strict standard was a welcome one. Each game approved by Nintendo would receive the Nintendo seal of quality. In their own words, assurance that Nintendo has approved and guaranteed quality of the product, an implementation intended to quell any fears those suffering from the PTSD of just a couple years prior may experience. This doesn't mean that every game was fantastic. There were still plenty of duds on Nintendo's first home console, but it was a far cry from what was seen with the Atari or Magnavox Odyssey 2. There were also several companies, most notably Tengen, a subsidiary of Atari, that were able to skirt these regulations by getting past the lockout chip. At this point, though, Nintendo had already secured such a hold on the market that their approved games were selling incredibly well, and customers had been programmed to check for the seal of quality before purchasing a title. In addition, if retailers tried to sell these unlicensed games, Nintendo would threaten to pull all of their own officially published ones. This was a pretty serious threat, considering the popularity of their own games were rivaled by no other companies. By 1990, Nintendo would achieve a nearly 90% share in the home console market in America, not only revitalizing the industry and reconnecting all generations with the relatively new and exciting medium of video games, but building a foundation from which all future consoles would be built. While Nintendo was hardly the first to do anything, they remained the most iconic console from this era, their name synonymous with retro games and parents who never learned the names of any other game companies. Also, just to get it out of the way, I am fully aware of the predatory business practices that Nintendo had, especially during this time. But that's not really the focus of this project, so I will not be going into that with any more detail. Anyways, this is about the Black Box set. They were the NES's launch titles and would be the only first-party developed games until 1987. Although Nintendo didn't have control over all box designs for third-party companies, leaving quite a lot of variation, they made sure to have a very standardized design for their own releases. They all featured a sleek black box, speckled with a starry sky, allowing easy identification as a first-party Nintendo title, and reinforcing the futuristic design of the console and its accessories. A screenshot from the game was put on the front cover, rather than an artistic rendition of gameplay. This was an intentional decision by Gail Tilden, Nintendo's head of advertising, and Don James, an executive within the branch, in order to diminish any sense of false advertising. The game's title was boldly lettered and underscored with a reminder of the console it was made for. In the bottom right corner lay the seal of quality, while the bottom left showed which series the game was from. There were always several screenshots of gameplay along with a quick blurb on the back, another seal of quality just to make sure that nobody missed the first one, and another reminder or two that the game was, in fact, for use with the Nintendo Entertainment System. Well, I mean, all of these seals of quality must have meant that they were thoroughly vetted by Nintendo, right? All of these were fantastic games, pinnacles of their time. Well, while most of them have aged pretty poorly by today's standards, I argue that almost every game in the set does actually have some impact on the future of their respective genres.